continue looking at the Sermon on the Mount, a very brief view of the Sermon on the Mount. I think I mentioned to you the other day that when I first started teaching for DTSs in Canada, which is also British Columbia as we are here now, but we were in Winfield, British Columbia, they had me teaching on the Sermon on the Mount for a week. But as I mentioned, I rarely got beyond the Beatitudes. I could take 6 weeks, I think, probably, on the Sermon on the Mount, because it's compressed almost the entire ethical teaching of Jesus into a short place. And what makes it so easy to spend a lot of time with it is how many times a single sentence in the Sermon on the Mount is illustrated by other passages, a lot of other passages, because it's pregnant in its statements. We're looking at the Beatitudes, which are at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount a moment ago, and we're going to pick it up now at verse 13, where Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one can, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." Now, at this point, Jesus has not clarified what good works look like, and that's what he's going to go into next, what it really means to live a righteous life. But he's making it very clear that the living of a righteous life, doing good works, is an essential part of the definition of what it means to be light to the world, or salt of the earth. Now, salt and light put together here are ways of telling these people who are no doubt intended to mean those who are described in the Beatitudes, those who are poor in spirit, those who mourn, those who are merciful, those who are pure in heart, those who are persecuted, those who are described in the Beatitudes, such people as those are the light of the world. Such people as those are the salt of the earth. Now, these references to salt of the earth and light of the world suggest something about the world in contrast to the disciples. The disciples, who fit the description of the Beatitudes, stand out from the world. They stand out from the earth and have a function serviceable to the world. Salt, of course, has many functions. We think of it these days largely as something you use to season your food. And they used it for that too in biblical times. Even back in the time of Job, probably the oldest book in the Bible, it says, "Can that which is unsavory be eaten without salt?" It says in Job. So, I mean, obviously salt was known from earliest times to be a seasoning for food, for things that didn't have very strong taste themselves. But salt had a more utilitarian purpose for which it was better known. And that was as a preservative, because, of course, they didn't have refrigeration back then. We who live in the 21st century, or even the 20th century before, as some of us did, we had refrigeration. We're born with that available to us. So we could put food away and freeze it for a year or more and it'd still be good to eat. You could slaughter a whole cow and put it in the freezer and eat it all year long. That's a fairly modern invention. Most of history, people couldn't do that. And imagine if you slaughtered a cow and your family could eat a little part of it that night, maybe the next night. But then the rest just rots, because you can't freeze it. You can't do anything to keep it from rotting, except you could pack it in salt. You could make jerky out of it, or you could just pack it in salt. And salt inhibits the growth of the bacteria and things like that that make it go bad. Salt was a preservative, and it was the only and best one they really had. I guess you could preserve things in alcohol, but they wouldn't be very good to eat meat that was preserved in alcohol. But that's one reason they had wine at every table too, is that they could kill bacteria with that. They had to put that in their water to make their water drinkable. But they had different ways than we do of making food last, because food is perishable and the world is perishable. Food rots and the world rots. Now, when Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth," the word earth in the Greek, ge, is the word for land as well as earth. And when the land is mentioned in a Jewish context, it often means the land of Israel. The land is in contrast to the Gentile world, the land of Israel. It's possible he's using the word earth here to mean land instead, because the same Greek word means both. In which case he'd be saying, in Israel, there is a tendency to rot morally. You can see it in Israel's history. There were revivals from time to time under the different judges. There were revivals under a few of the kings like Josiah and Hezekiah, but didn't last. There's a tendency to go bad in human nature. There was that tendency in Israel. There's that tendency in the world at large. Salt is that which inhibits or slows down rot. And therefore, Jesus seems to be saying that the people who fit the description that he's just given in the Beatitudes are people who tend to preserve human society from the more rapid decay that it would naturally experience. You see, for example, just before the time of the flood, that it says in Genesis 6 that there was such decay of morals that God had to eliminate everybody except the family of Noah. It says that he saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that the thoughts and intents of men's hearts were only evil continually. That's how bad it had become. It hadn't always been that bad, but it got that bad. And it may be suggested, although there's dispute about this, that the sons of God who married the daughters of men, which is mentioned just before that assessment of human society, is a reference to godly people compromising and marrying outside of the godly line. That a godly family, godly people marrying godly people, raising godly children, tends to preserve society from rapid decay. But when the sons of God, godly men, began to just choose wives, as it says, based on seeing they were beautiful and choosing them on that basis only, they weren't choosing godly wives anymore. And therefore, it could be suggesting that this is how the rot became so bad, that it had to be destroyed in the time of the flood. Now, the presence of the church is supposed to be salt to the society we're in. Salt is useful because it has a distinctive set of chemical properties. Salt has a certain character to it that other substances don't have. And those properties are that which makes it possible to preserve things like meat in salt and inhibit rot. Likewise, the church, the disciples of Jesus, have a distinctive character, which he says, if you lose that saltiness, if you lose that character, then you'll do no good. You will not be salt to the earth. You'll not preserve the rot. In fact, you won't even be respected. You'll be cast out and trodden under feet by men, suggesting that the church, when it loses its distinctive character, its godliness, will not only fail to prevent the decline of society, it will also be hated and despised by society. You know, we live in a time where many churches exhibit a lot of compromise with the world. There are godly Christians still. There's still salt in the earth. But there are a lot of people who name the name of Christ in institutions called Christian that are more copying the world than holding out against the rot of the world. And many times, because of the desire to be popular in the world and not be trodden under the foot of men, as it were, we want to become more like the world. But if the salt becomes more like the meat, it's of no value to the meat. Sometimes we may imagine that if we become more like the world, they will persecute us less. The truth is, they will despise us more. The world may hate an uncompromised Christian because an uncompromised Christian makes them feel guilty, but it despises them and has no respect for a compromised Christian. The world knows that Christians are supposed to be different. Actually, Christians are preaching a different way of life. If they're not living a different way of life, they're simply seen as hypocrites and despised for that. The world hates a compromised church. The church compromises to win the favor of the world, but instead they win the contempt of the world, and they get trodden underfoot by men. And basically, Western civilization, as we are standing here, sitting here right now, North America, Europe, Australia, those regions that were once part of Christian Western civilization, have departed in large measure from Christian roots, both in terms of societal norms and in terms of even the way the churches are in many cases. And we see that people don't respect Christianity anymore. People will respect, even if they hate it, Christianity as something, as a force to be reckoned with, when it does not lose its saltiness. But let salt lose its saltiness, and it's got nothing to commend it to anybody for. That's what Jesus says. You need to keep your distinctives, which distinctives are going to be outlined, have been outlined in the Beatitudes, and will be outlined in the teaching that Jesus is about to give. He also compares this with light in the world at large. This very suggestion is telling us something about the world as well as ourselves. If we are the light of the world, then the world must be in darkness. The world must need light. The world must be, that is, blind. They don't see the right way to go. We do. Why? Well, because we're following Jesus, and he's the light of the world. And because he's the light of the world, we have light, and we become light bearers also. We are the light of the world because we imitate and follow Christ. And we therefore become guides to the world. It's interesting that even worldly people, sometimes who don't embrace Christianity, are often illuminated by Christianity to the extent that their morals improve. The presence of the church in Western civilization has had a positive effect throughout history upon those civilizations, even though the majority of the people in Western civilization never really became true disciples of Jesus. Yet the moral awareness, the moral sensitivities were raised. The whole idea that people ought to respect age, ought to respect women, ought to respect the poor, ought to respect children, ought to have compassion on the sick. These are things that are not found in every society. When Mother Teresa came to Calcutta, which was all Hindu before she got there, nobody cared for the lepers. Nobody cared for the people who were starving to death and dying in the streets. The religion of Hinduism teaches karma, that these people are suffering from bad karma from a previous life. Don't interrupt that, or else they'll have to come back and do it again. Let them suffer. Let them go through it. That way they'll get this bad karma out of their cycle, and they can come back better off next time. Christianity has a different view. There's no karma. There's no next time. You need to have compassion on the poor. So Mother Teresa comes in, and she shows compassion to the poor. And now, even the non-Christians in Calcutta have gotten the idea. People around the world get ideas from the church. There are hospitals now, even atheists establish hospitals, but the first ones for Christians did. Secular societies have care for orphans now, but it was the Christians who first started orphanages. Christians show a better way because Christians have the light and become light to the world. And he said, let the world see your good works. That's how you let your light shine before men, that they'll see your good works and they'll glorify God. Now, it's interesting because when you get to chapter 6, he's telling you don't let your alms, don't do them to be seen by men. And it sounds like a contradiction. He just said, let your good works be seen by men. And then in chapter 6, verse 20, he says, don't do your alms to be seen by men, or else you have your reward. Here we, of course, have to be realistic and not try to find fault where there isn't fault. In the one case, in Matthew 6, where he says, don't do your good deeds to be seen by men, or else you'll have your reward. He's talking about doing them in order to have glory for yourself, to have men notice you and think well of you. In chapter 5, he says, let your light shine before men that they'll see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. That is to say, you're not doing anything to glorify yourself. You're doing it to glorify your Father. You might get some credit in the process, but you're not looking for that. You don't want that. What you're doing is to bring glory to your Father. And to do that, you have to live a certain way that is distinctive. Sure, people are going to see that. You can't help that. And they might even think well of you in some cases, although as often as not, they'll probably persecute you for it. The point is, you don't care. You're not doing your good works so that you can get some kind of recognition. You're doing it so that people see the way you live and glorify God, because you exhibit God to them in a way they've never seen him before. That's what being light is. That's what being salt is. Then he says, and this is very important, verse 17 introduces the rest of chapter 5 and is easily misunderstood. He says, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of these least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, what's interesting here is Jesus said he didn't come to destroy or abolish the law and the prophets. And he said, whoever disobeys or teaches others to disobey the least of these commands, he means Old Testament commands, will be the least in the kingdom of heaven. It makes it sound like Christians are now supposed to see the permanence of the Torah and live under its rule. There are a lot of Christians today who misunderstand this. They're called Hebrew roots or Torah observant Christians who believe that we should be keeping the kosher laws, we should be of course circumcised, we should be keeping Sabbath, keeping the Jewish festivals, whatever. We should be keeping the law because Jesus did not come to abolish the law. But realize Jesus is talking to people who are Jews living under the law and would continue to be Jews living under the law for several years after this sermon was given. He's talking to his disciples about how to live their lives, as it were, under the law in this case, until it is fulfilled. He said, not one letter or stroke of a pen will pass from the law until it's fulfilled. Now, of course, when it's fulfilled, then it will. And the question then is, when is it fulfilled? The New Testament seems to teach in many ways that Jesus, in his life, death, and resurrection, is the fulfillment of the law, that he fulfilled it, especially in his death. And that being so, the time between the time he's giving the sermon, the time that he died, was still a significant period of time that his disciples needed to be continuing under the law. Jesus himself was born under the law, it says in Galatians 4:4. Remember, he was circumcised as a baby. He basically kept the law with certain exceptions, which we'll talk about later on. And the disciples were expected to keep the law until it was fulfilled. Now, why did he say, don't think that I came to abolish the law and the prophets? Because Jesus was going to do things that might look like he was adverse to the law and the prophets. He was going to break the Sabbath. That is, he's going to do things that were counted to be a breach of the Sabbath, and therefore some might say, well, he's against the law. Certainly there were people who questioned whether Jesus was in favor of the law or not when they brought the woman taken in adultery. They said, Moses said she'd be put to death. What do you say? Like, I got a feeling you might say something different than Moses. Like, you might undermine what Moses said. And Jesus, because he associated with law breakers, like publicans and sinners, was often thought to be a lawbreaker himself. And he was going to live with a radical liberty with reference to many things in the law. And he's going to declare all foods clean, for example, at some point. He's not going to keep the traditions of the rabbis and the way they wash their hands. He's going to be doing things differently that people might say, is he like here to undermine the law? Now, the law was the whole cultural foundation for Israel. The temple was the center of their life. The law had to do with how you remain clean or unclean, can participate in the temple, how your sacrifice be offered, how you keep faithful to the temple cultus and to God and the covenant he made at Sinai. That was all their culture was about. And Jesus was not against that in the sense that he wasn't coming to abolish it, but he did say he's coming to fulfill it. Many times when people say, oh, Jesus didn't abolish the law, so we have to keep it, they only read the first part of his statement, not the second part. I did come to fulfill it. Well, what's that mean, to fulfill it? It means that the law itself anticipated something, just as when Jesus fulfilled prophecy. The prophecy anticipated, predicted something, and Jesus was that. He fulfilled it. The law also anticipated something. The rituals that were kept, the Passover and the Sabbath and the sacrifices and all the things that were part of it, were types and shadows, and they anticipated Christ, that he came to be that which they anticipated. They were going to go away, but not because he was abolishing or destroying or coming as an agent hostile to them, but because he was doing what they wanted him to do, what they anticipated him to do. The laws themselves were predicting that he would do these things, and he came to do them and to bring the law to its fulfillment, which is indeed the end of the law. Paul said that Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to those who believe. Paul in Galatians talked about it as like the law was a schoolmaster, which is for children. But when faith has come and maturity has come, then we're no longer under the schoolmaster. Paul gives the example of even the heir of a fortune is no better than a servant when he's a child, and he's kept under tutors and guardians until the time set by his father. But we were under the law, he says, until the time, fullness of times came, and Christ came and redeemed us from that. What Paul's saying is this, that the law, the period of time living under the law, is like being a child of God in childhood. Becoming a Christian is like passing from childhood to adulthood. We're redeemed from the law. An heir is kept under tutors like the law until he reaches adulthood. Now, what is the relationship of an adult to the same person when he was a child? Did he destroy the child? I was a little boy once. Now I'm a grown man. Did I destroy the little boy who was me? No, I didn't. I fulfilled. The very presence of a baby born is the prediction of a human adult someday. Something may interrupt that and prevent it, but the very presence of a child is the anticipation of eventually an adult. When the adult is there, there's no more child. The child is gone. But he hasn't been destroyed. He's been fulfilled. He's come to his fullness, to his maturity. And Jesus did that with the law. The law anticipated Christ. He didn't come to be hostile toward it or destroy it. He just came to fulfill what it was anticipating. Now, when he does, then it's no longer needed. We're no longer under the schoolmaster, no longer under the tutor, once faith in Christ has come, Paul said. And that's no doubt what Jesus would have said too if he was asked that in those specific terms. I didn't come to destroy, but to fulfill. And not one jot or tittle of the law will pass until all is fulfilled. So we know that all must be fulfilled, because if not, then all the law is still binding. That would include the sacrifices and circumcision and everything under the law. Not one jot or tittle will pass until it's all fulfilled. Well, some of it certainly has passed. There's no more sacrifice, no more temple, no more priesthood, no more circumcision. Those are plainly stated in the New Testament. So if those have passed, then it must all be fulfilled. Because nothing will pass until it's all fulfilled, he said. So, to his disciples living under the law, he says, you need to keep the law. Anyone who says, don't keep the law, at this point, while it's still binding, is going to be the least in my kingdom. But that doesn't mean that his disciples throughout history will keep the law, because the law was going to be fulfilled, as he says in verse 17, he came to fulfill it. And when he did, then our relationship is different. Now, in the following rest of the chapter, he even gives the example of what his disciples should do when they bring a sacrifice to the altar. He tells them, if you bring your gift to the altar, and you there remember that someone has something against you, go make peace and so forth with them. You know, the passage is in verse 23 and 24 here. So he's writing to, or speaking to, I should say, Jews who were his followers, who were still for a while longer going to be under the law. But he wanted them to understand what the whole intent of the law was. He said, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you'll not enter the kingdom. Well, how could you, if keeping the law is the basis of righteousness, how could you ever exceed the scribes and Pharisees? They were full-time religionists. They kept the law for a living. That was all they did. How could you exceed that? Well, you could exceed it in quality, if not in quantity. You couldn't do more law-keeping acts than the Pharisees did, but you could do a better quality of law-keeping. That's what Jesus goes on to point out. He gives them six examples of things in the law, all of which are things that they had been taught by their rabbis in the synagogues. And he begins by saying, you've heard that it was said to those of old time. Now, it was said to them by Moses, but it was also said to them repeatedly in the synagogues every Sabbath, these different laws. These laws were defining a way of life that was to set Israel distinct from the nations. But Jesus says, I'm going to have to make you even more distinct than Israel as a whole. You're going to become distinct from Israel in general. Because it may be that they don't murder, but they do a lot of things that God doesn't approve of. It may be they don't commit adultery, but they still do things in their hearts that God doesn't approve of. So I want my disciples to know that real righteousness isn't just the external keeping of rules. That's what religion is. Real righteousness is a different heart, different motivations, different set of inward commitments that governs all your behavior, not just the extreme cases of murder and adultery and that kind of stuff. Everything, all the little things in your life have got to be coming from a heart that is different. Now, he doesn't use the word love in all these cases, although he does in the sixth instance he gives here at the end, you need to love your enemies. But we do know that what Jesus is talking about is love. And on other occasions, when they asked Jesus, what is the great commandment? He said, well, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. This is the whole law and the prophets. We see him making a similar statement in the Sermon on the Mount in chapter 7, verse 12. He said, what you would have men do to you, do that to them also. This is the whole law and the prophets. So, love your neighbor as you love yourself is the whole law and the prophets. Do to others what you want done to you is what it means to love your neighbor as you love yourself. That's the whole law and the prophets, he said. There's only one thing that God is really looking for. He's not looking for you to make a long list of rules. The Jews had 613 commandments they had to keep. That's the ones Moses gave. Then they had all the traditions of the rabbis and the Talmud, which were innumerable. To them, living a righteous life was memorizing all kinds of minute rules and nervously seeking to avoid infraction. She said, no, that's not what righteousness is. Righteousness is a different heart. If your heart loves God fully and loves your neighbor as you love yourself, that's pretty much all you have to remember, because all the law and the prophets hang on those two things. And when he gives these teachings in the Sermon on the Mount, he doesn't use the word love throughout, but he's talking about love. He's saying, you've heard you shouldn't murder. You've heard you shouldn't commit adultery. You've heard you shouldn't lightly divorce your wife without giving her a bill of divorcement. You've heard you shouldn't break your oaths. You've heard that you should, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. You've heard you have to love your neighbor, but you can hate your enemy. But I say to you, and in every case what he says is really saying it goes to the matter of the heart. All the things that we're talking about have to do with having a different kind of a heart than the average religious person has. Because religion can be practiced completely without a heart for it. Even the most religious Jews, Jesus said that Isaiah had spoken of them properly, saying, these people draw near to me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And so Jesus is talking about how your heart has to be changed by the love of God and love for your neighbor, so that all that you do is reflective of that, and that goes far beyond the mere things the law said you cannot do and can do. So he gives the example, he gives six examples: murder, adultery, divorce, oaths, an eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth, we call that retaliation, and then love for your enemies. Those are the six examples he gives. In fact, I understand these six examples to illustrate three larger principles, which Jesus elsewhere called the weightier matters of the law. In Matthew 23:23, that's easy to remember, Matthew 23:23, Jesus blasted the Pharisees because he said they pay their tithes of mint, anise, and cumin, but they neglect the weightier matters of the law. Then he identified the weightier matters of the law as justice and mercy and faithfulness. Now this is what love is. Love isn't a good vibe or a warm feeling you feel to someone. It's treating people justly, treating people mercifully, treating people faithfully. In other words, doing to others what you want done to you. You want people to be just and fair to you? Of course. Do you want people to be merciful to you when you need it? Of course. Do you want people to keep their promises to you? Obviously. Well, then do that to them, and you have fulfilled the whole law and the prophets. Be just, be merciful, be faithful. That's the weightier matters of the law. They're simply the components of what it means to love. Love is what you do more than what you feel. This is another problem we have in our society, and Christians often don't understand. They say, how can I love my enemy? I don't love that person. You're thinking of a feeling. Love is more like a commitment to action, a commitment to lay down your life for someone else. Jesus said, greater love has no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. It's something you do. That's why Jesus paraphrased the command, you shall love your neighbor as you love yourself, in the terms we call the golden rule. What you want to be done to you, do that to them. That's love your neighbor as you love yourself. It's what you do. It's how you treat other people. It's the commitment you have to their well-being, even if it costs you laying down your life. That's love. You might not feel warm toward them. It doesn't matter. It's nicer if you do. It's a lot easier to lay down your life for someone if you like them. But if you don't, it doesn't matter. You still have to lay down your life for them. You still have to love in the sense that you are committed to justice and mercy and faithfulness in all your dealings toward them. And I believe that the six examples he gives in chapter 5 of Matthew, two of them are about justice, and two of them are about faithfulness, and two of them are about mercy. That's my reading of it. The first two are about murder and adultery. Of the six examples, these are the only two Jesus draws from the Ten Commandments. They are the sixth and seventh commandment. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery. I believe that the Ten Commandments, once they start talking about your relationship with people, and that begins in the fifth commandment, honor your father and your mother, and the rest of the Ten Commandments after that, the other six, the other five after that, those are all about love your neighbors, you love yourself, and they're all about justice. Justice means that you give people no less than what they deserve, in a good sense. You might not give them what they deserve in a bad sense. That's mercy. If they deserve punishment and you don't give it to them, that's mercy. But you cannot give people less than what they deserve. If something is owed to somebody, you better observe that. You better observe their rights. People have a right to their life, unless they forfeit it by doing some capital crime. But they have a right to their life, so you have no right to take it from them. That's an injustice. Murder is an injustice. Sometimes people think Christians are inconsistent and not all Christians take these two positions, but many conservative Christians, where I come from, take two positions that liberal people think are inconsistent. Most conservative Christians believe that abortion is evil, but they believe in capital punishment. And liberals usually don't believe either of those things. They're for abortion and against capital punishment. And they sometimes will mock the Christian who's supposed to be pro-life and say, well, you say you're pro-life, but you're for killing criminals, which we're not. So you're not really pro-life, are you? Well, a Christian who takes those positions say, I'm pro-justice. It's wrong to kill a baby because they're innocent. It's not wrong to kill somebody who's done something worthy of death, which is a term Paul uses a number of times, including of himself when he's on trial for his life. He says, if I've done something worthy of death, I don't object to dying. In Acts 25, 10 or 11, he believed in capital punishment. If I've done something that deserves death, I don't object to being executed. But he says, I haven't done these things, so you can't have me. I'm going to appeal to Caesar. But the point is that the Bible acknowledges that some actions are worthy of death. If you give something they deserve, that's justice. If somebody does something worthy of death and they are put to death, that's justice. It's not a matter of pro-life, it's a matter of pro-justice. An innocent person should not be killed. A baby and a woman is an innocent person. Therefore, it's an injustice. A person who's done something worthy of death who is put to death, that's not an injustice. Now, there are Christians who are against the penalty of death, too, and I'm not going to argue that case here. All I can say is, even if we should say, well, we should show mercy to murderers and not kill them, that case can be made. But the fact remains that we're giving them something better than they deserve if we show mercy to them. When somebody does something worthy of death, what they deserve is death, by definition. And that's what the law of Moses said about many crimes. They were worthy of death. And God, who is a perfectly just God, whose law never had any injustice in it, commanded death for certain things. Murder and capital punishment are opposites. One is an injustice, and the other is just. But there's other ways to be unjust besides murdering people. Most of us will never murder anyone, but you can be equally unjust by being angry at somebody without a just cause. You can be unjustly angry at someone just because they irritate you, or they've done something that doesn't please you. Or, as he put it, if you have done something wrong to your neighbor, if you have violated your neighbor's rights somehow and done an injustice, and you come to worship God, leave your gift at the altar and go and make it right with the person. He's talking about if you've done something wrong to them and they're holding it against you. If you remember, he has something against you. That means you did something to him and he's holding it against you. Well, don't leave that unredressed. You go back and fix it. Go back and make restitution or whatever you have to do to make it right, to make it just. Then come and offer your gift. He's saying God doesn't want you to worship him if you're neglecting to be just toward your neighbor and your relations. He even talks about when you've done something wrong and your neighbor is taking you to court. He says, agree with your adversary while you're with him on the way, lest he turn you over to the judge and the judge to the officer and the officer turns you over to prison. He says, you won't get out of there until you paid your last farthing. What's that about? He's talking about justice. You should live in justice, and where you may have neglected justice, get it right. Make it right before you worship God. In fact, make it right before you get to court. Because if you've done an injustice to someone and the court finds you guilty, you're going to jail. And don't think I'm going to get you out. You'll be there until you've paid the whole penalty. Now, God might spring an innocent man out of jail, like Peter. In Acts chapter 12, the angel comes and lets him out of jail because he's innocent. But you say, if you're guilty and you haven't made it right, if you haven't corrected it, if you haven't paid the restitution you owe, if you let it go to court, I'm going to leave you to the mercy of the court. You won't get out of there until you pay all the penalty that the court says you owe, because God is not going to give you special favors if you're neglecting justice in your dealings with other people. And that's what courts administrate, is justice, supposedly. It's when there is an injustice done that you are taken to court. And so Christ is saying here, yeah, you're not supposed to murder, but that's like an extreme case of injustice. God is concerned about justice in all dealings, in all your relations. Same thing with you shall not commit adultery, his second example. That's also an injustice. It's unjust to overstep the rights of a man or a woman to their spouse. When people get married, they become uniquely, as it were, the possession of the other party. Of course, we live in a time where no one wants to be thought of as a possession of property. But the truth of the matter is, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 7, the husband has no right over his own body, but his wife has that right. And the wife has no power over her own body, but the husband has that right. Husbands and wives by covenant belong to each other, just as God and Israel by covenant belong to each other. He says, I will be their God, they will be my people. There's ownership there. And as much as we revolt against the idea of people owning people, the truth is a covenant brings people into obligation to each other that is a unique bond, where both parties have the right to expect the other to be faithful. And if you a third party comes in and seduces the husband or seduces the wife, that's an injustice. That's overstepping the rights of the partner who's being cheated. That's an injustice. Now, Jesus said it's not only that, though. If you even want to do that in your mind, then you don't have a heart that's governed by love and justice. If you look at your neighbor's wife and want to sleep with her, but you don't do it, you commit adultery with her in your heart. Basically, what he's saying is you have to be radically committed to not violating your neighbor, even in your mind. Now, that statement about looking with lust, I just want to say that's often misquoted and misunderstood. Let me see how it reads in this one. I say to you, verse 28, everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery. That's not a good translation. Many modern translations have really mistranslated and misconstrued what Jesus said. I think the NIV says whoever looks at a woman lustfully. That's bad too. This one says whoever looks at a woman with lust. That's not what Jesus said. You can look it up in the Greek if you want. The better translations read it more accurately. It is whoever looks at a woman to lust after her. That's a statement of purpose. That's a statement of intention. To say whoever looks at a woman with lust or whoever looks lustfully, that's ambiguous. Because unfortunately, and you women have to stop your ears here because I'm going to talk to men about something that only men know about. You women are not supposed to be let in on this. Some sort of a trade secret of men. Men lust after women. visually. Good men don't want to. Good men strive not to. But men are so wired that images of women arouse hormonal things in them that brings desire. That's what lust is. Lust just means desire. It's an ordinary word for desire. Jesus used the same word, same Greek word here is used when Jesus said, "With much desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." In Luke, it's an ordinary word for desire. Whoever looks at a woman in order to desire her. Now, this is talking about somebody else's wife, because as you're committing adultery, so that'd be the woman in question is somebody else's wife, not yours. You're committing adultery by desiring this other man's wife. But if you're looking at her to desire her, there's something wrong with your motivations, because you're not avoiding adultery. Now, what often happens with men, and I talk to them all the time because they're frustrated about this, they are trying to be godly. They're trying to be pure. They're trying to keep their mind off sex, and they'll be walking down the street or at an office where they work or at school or somewhere like that, and they'll see a woman who's dressed provocatively, someone who's attractive, and they'll see her and something will be aroused in them. And then say, "Oh no, I've committed adultery in my heart because I suddenly have this desire that has been aroused. I didn't ask for it, it just happened. I didn't look at her for that. I didn't even know she was there until a moment ago, and now there's this desire." That is not what Jesus is talking about. That is, of course, temptation. Men are tempted visually by women. I'm told by some women that women can be visually tempted by men too. I suppose that's true, but I don't think it's quite the same thing as what men struggle with. Women, I think, are usually more interested in the way a man treats them than the way he looks, but men don't care how a woman treats them, as long as she looks at them. I'm just talking about natural. I'm not talking about Christian men's commitments. I'm talking about the way people are wired. And so a man should not feel guilty that he experiences a temptation, because Jesus was tempted in all points like we are, yet without sin. Temptation is not sin. The Bible says in the first chapter of James that every man is tempted when he's drawn away by his own lust or desire and enticed. And when desire conceives, it brings forth sin. When does desire conceive? When does a desire or a lust become sin? It happens when you decide to own it. When you are, many, and men and women are temptations of all kinds come to you throughout the day. It is a suggestion. It is an offer. The enemy is trying to see if he can draw you to do something that you're not supposed to do. You feel the drive. You feel the temptation. That's, if you didn't, you wouldn't be human and you wouldn't be tempted. But you are tempted because there is a desire there. But when you say, "But I don't approve of that. That thing I'm being tempted to do, I don't want that. I will not do that." As long as you're saying no to it, you don't own it. It's just a temptation. It may continue for a long time. As long as you say no, it's not yours. But when you finally say, "Okay, I agree," then it's yours. That lust has conceived. It brings forth sin. When you are being tempted with anything that you shouldn't have, and you say, "No, that's not mine. I'm not supposed to have that. That's wrong," you're just being tempted. As soon as you say yes, then you've sinned, whether you commit any act or not. Your heart has chosen it. And when you look at a woman in order to lust after her, that's, your heart's already decided that it wants to enjoy some sexual fantasy about a woman. That's an intention of the heart. It's not an accidental thing where a temptation arises unbidden. It's talking about something that's intentional. And men, many men do those things. Now, I've been a Christian most of my life, and I've spent most of my entire life trying to avoid looking at women that way. And most of the men I know are godly Christians who try very hard to avoid looking at women that way. So it's hard for me to imagine any man, because almost all my friends are Christians, sitting around wanting to look and lust after women. I know the temptation, but I can't imagine any man wanting to give in to that temptation. It's a torment to most Christians. It's a trial to most Christians. But there are men, and I'm sure in Israel, those who were not followers of Christ, even the Pharisees who were not out committing adultery, they were enjoying visually, sexually, women that were not their wives, that were other men's wives. And that's what Jesus is saying. You're committing adultery. Even though you're not doing it outright, you're doing it in your heart. And that is unjust. You're taking visually, you're taking pleasure from somebody that doesn't belong to you, it belongs to someone else. That's supposed to be left to her husband. Now, there's two illustrations about faithfulness. One is about divorce, and one is about keeping oaths. These are often misunderstood also. And by the way, divorce is a controversial subject in the New Testament. There are Christians who think that divorce is always wrong. Some believe that divorce is okay in some cases, but remarriage is always wrong. There's some who think that divorce and remarriage are okay in certain circumstances. There's some who think that you can divorce and remarriage at a whim. There's all a whole range of different views. The view I hold about this is based on what Jesus said here and is basically the view that most Protestants have taken, though you'll find people who take it otherwise. Jesus said, you've heard that it was said, if you divorce your wife, give her a bill of divorcement. Well, it does say that in Deuteronomy 24, but it doesn't say why you might divorce your wife. In Deuteronomy 24, it says, if you find some uncleanness in her, but that's rather vague. I told you that Shammai and Hillel, the two rabbis, had different views about what constitutes uncleanness and grounds for divorce. Hillel thought you could divorce your wife for just about anything. Shammai thought you could only do it for if she was unfaithful. On both occasions that Jesus addressed this in Matthew, here in 5:32 and also in chapter 19, verse 9, he seemed to side with Shammai. Only in the case of fornication could you divorce your wife. But the point he's making here is this. The Jews, they made vows to faithfulness to their wives, and they would break them. If they found a woman they liked better, or if they just found their own wife to be obnoxious and didn't like her anymore, or unattractive, they'd just divorce her. And they wouldn't think much of it, because the law said they could give her a writing of divorcement and be done with her. But Jesus pointed out there's something going on here that's sinful, and that is you're being unfaithful. If you divorce your wife for any reason other than that she's already been unfaithful to you, then you're the one being unfaithful. You are committing an unfaithful act. You made a vow. When you make a vow, you have to keep your vows or else you're unfaithful. Every divorce that takes place is the result of unfaithfulness. There's no divorce has ever occurred in the history of man that was caused by anything other than unfaithfulness. Sometimes people divide over pressures of finances or sexual incompatibility or other things, and they don't divide because one has an affair. They divide just because of something else, but that's unfaithfulness because they promised to stay together. When you make a vow in marriage, you promise to be there for better, for worse, for richer, or poor, until you, as long as you both shall live. You make a vow, you keep it. If you don't keep it, you're unfaithful. And that's what Jesus is saying. Now, there'd be one exception. If your spouse has already been unfaithful, then the vow's been broken by her. If she's divorced, if you divorce her for that reason, you're not being unfaithful because the unfaithfulness has already occurred on her side. The vow's been, the covenant's been broken. But anything short of that, if you divorce your wife, you're being unfaithful. And if you remarry somebody, you're committing adultery in that marriage. That's what Jesus said. He's talking about the need for faithfulness. And that's also the concern of the next illustration about taking oaths. He says, you've heard that if you take oaths, you should keep your oaths. Well, that's true. The Old Testament does say that. And in fact, the Old Testament even says they should take their oaths in the name of Yahweh. People would take oaths in order to keep them honest. Today, we sign contracts for that. There was a time in Western civilization where a handshake between two parties might be enough to keep them honest. But in biblical times, it was an oath. The idea was, if I'm promising you something and you don't know me well enough to know if you can trust me, I could make you trust me more by saying, I swear by God. I swear by Jerusalem. I swear by the temple. I will do it. And then you trust me because I'm invoking something more virtuous than me, something holier than me. And therefore, I'm basically saying, if I break this vow, I am blaspheming God. I'm blaspheming the temple. I'm blaspheming the thing that I'm swearing by. So it says in Hebrews chapter 6, men always take oaths by something greater than themselves. The reason is because you would only take an oath if people didn't distrust you already. You have to swear by something that they do trust, something greater than you. And you then invoke the virtue of that thing that you're swearing by. Now, the Pharisees had a whole bunch of oaths that they swore by. And they were legal experts. They had a bunch of oaths that they had decided were not binding oaths. You find this in Matthew 23, when he's castigating the scribes and Pharisees, Jesus said, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, for you say that if a man swears by the temple, it's not binding. But if he swears by the gold of the temple, it is binding. You say that if he swears by the altar, it's not binding. But if he swears by the gift on the altar, it is binding." This is what the Pharisees had done. They had decided that some oaths they could take wouldn't bind them and some would. But the average Joe on the street didn't have these legal expertise. They didn't know what was binding, what wasn't. So if a Pharisee wanted to buy a man's donkey and say, "Listen, I'll take the donkey today, I'll send you the money Wednesday, and I swear by the temple." Well, the average guy selling the donkey said, "Well, he wouldn't swear by the temple if he wasn't telling the truth. Okay, I'll trust you." But when the guy comes back for his money on Wednesday and you say, "Well, I don't have the money, I'm not going to pay you, thanks." And they say, "But you swore by the temple." The Pharisee would say, "Well, I swore by the temple. I didn't swear by the gold at the temple. Check it out. That's not binding, what I did." In other words, I can lie to you while taking an oath. I can fool you. And that's why Jesus said, don't even take oaths. Just be honest. He said, let your yea be yea and your nay nay. Don't even swear at all. He's not saying that swearing oaths is a bad thing. He's saying that the whole system of swearing oaths had been corrupted into just another way of deceiving people, and his disciples should avoid it altogether and just say yes and keep their promise as if they'd made an oath. And just say no and keep their word. And you need to be so honest that no oath is necessary to bind you. That's his argument. Again, this divorce and oath taking has to do with being faithful. One of the weightier matters of the law, justice and faithfulness. And the last two are about mercy. These are all very much often misunderstood. About the eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth that you find in this fifth example. You've heard an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But I say, don't resist the evil man. If someone strikes you on one cheek, on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. If a man wants to sue you and take your garment, give him your cloak also. If someone asks you for money, give it to him. And if he wants you to go 1 mile, go 2 miles with him. What's this about? Well, a lot of people think that Jesus was revoking the Old Testament command, an eye for an eye, tooth for tooth, because it sounds like he's saying the opposite thing here. But we have to understand what he is and is not saying. Eye for eye, tooth for tooth is part of the Old Testament law found in about two or three or four different places in the Old Testament when it's talking about how the judges of Israel are to administrate justice when a crime has been committed or a civil violation. If two men get in a fight and one man knocks out the other guy's eye, and the guy who lost his eye takes the guy to court, the judge says, "Okay, you who took his eye, your eye's going out." That's making sure that the penalty fits the crime. You knocked his tooth out, you get your tooth knocked out. This is the way that the courts, the magistrates, the judges were supposed to resolve conflicts. If you hurt me this much, then the judge is going to make you hurt that much, the same amount. Perfect justice. Now Jesus, when he said, "You've heard an eye for an eye, tooth for tooth," he's not saying, "But I say, throw that system out." Because Jesus wasn't talking to the judges. Jesus wasn't telling the judges of Israel to turn the other cheek when criminals are brought before them. What kind of society would you have if every time a violent criminal came to the court said, "I'm going to do what Jesus said, I'm going to turn the other cheek and just let you go." Well, that's not what the courts are there for, and Jesus wasn't talking to the courts. What he's saying to his disciples is this: if someone strikes you, let's say they knock out your tooth. Well, obviously the law says, as you know, that you could take his tooth out. You'd have to take it to court, of course, and the judge would say he has to have his tooth knocked out, and you could get fair retribution there, but you could do something else and not take it to court at all. Just let it go. Just absorb the injury. Isn't that merciful? It's more merciful. If a person strikes you and knocks your tooth out, justice would allow you to knock his tooth out. But mercy would be for you to forgo your rights and extend to him compassion. That's what mercy is. It means that you have a just recourse that would hurt him, but you don't want to hurt him. And therefore, you don't take that recourse. Jesus is not saying that the judges of Israel shall throw out this system of an eye for an eye, tooth for tooth, which is perfect justice. Jesus did not come and rearrange the laws of the society that were to be administered in the courts. He's talking to his disciples about their lives. If someone strikes you on one cheek, on the right cheek, just turn the other one. You could strike them back and you'd be within your rights, but be more merciful not to. Just let them have another one. if somebody makes you go a mile with him. Now, the Roman law said that a Roman soldier could press any bystander into service to carry his load, his equipment, for a mile. Any Jew who was unhappy enough to be standing nearest to a soldier who needed someone to carry his gear for a mile could be grabbed and he'd have to carry it for a mile. But after that mile, the Jew could walk away. If the guy had to go a second mile, he'd find a second Jew. But Jesus said, if someone compels you to go a mile with him, and nobody but a Roman soldier would do that, so he's talking about that particular law, he says, you go too with him. The idea being, the soldier has the right to make you go 1 mile, but he doesn't have right to make you go two. Be merciful. Go beyond what is owed to him. You owe him the first mile. You don't owe him the second one, but I'm saying be merciful. Go beyond justice. Be more than just. And that's, you know, that's what he's giving as an example. Be merciful. He's not saying that the courts should have a different system of judgment. He's saying you can just not even go to court. You can just absorb the injury and not press charges. And that would be more merciful, more loving. And the last example he gives is, you've heard that it was said you should love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Actually, the law never said the second part. The law does say you should love your neighbor in Leviticus. It never says you shall hate your enemy. Though some of the things in the Old Testament might give the impression that that was permitted. And the rabbis actually did teach that it was okay to hate your enemy. But Jesus said, no, you need to love your enemy. You need to do good to those who persecute you. Bless those who curse you. Treat those people well who don't treat you well. Why? So that you can be sons of your Father in heaven. Remember when we talked about being peacemakers? Blessed are the peacemakers, they shall be called the children of God. Why? Because God's a peacemaker. You be a peacemaker, you'll resemble your Father. Same thing, God loves his enemies, so you need to love your enemies so you'll be a child of your Father. Oh, does God really love his enemies? I thought there was a hell of fire. I thought there was horrible judgments in the Bible. There are those things. But although God does have to lower the boom and finally judge sin, day by day, he shows mercy to even his enemies. And Jesus says, God causes the sun to rise on the evil and on the good. Sunrise is a good thing. Evil people are bad, but God sends them sunrise, same as he does the good people. He causes the rain to fall on the evil and on the just. In other words, God is overabundant in his kindness, even toward his enemies. That doesn't mean he never judges them. A judge always has to eventually judge crime. But that doesn't mean he's disposed to hurt people. He rather would show mercy to everybody. And he says that's what he wants you to do. If you only love the people who love you, you're like the publicans. They do that. But you're not like God. He says you need to be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. That means complete in your love. Your love should not be restricted to those who love you and who are your friends. Your love should be more broad, more thorough, more complete. That's what the word perfect means. By the way, this very statement is also found in the parallel in Luke 6, except instead of be perfect, it's be merciful, as your Father in heaven is merciful, in the same place. So be perfect in your mercy, be complete in your mercy, in your kindness. So there are two examples, I think, that illustrate God's concerns for justice, two, his concern for faithfulness, and two, for mercy. And Jesus elsewhere said these are the weightier matters of the law. What they really boil down to is love. You're loving your neighbors, you love yourself if you treat him justly. You want to be treated justly, do it to him. If he's in need, if you were in need, you want someone to be merciful to you, so be merciful to him. You want people to keep their promises to you, of course, then keep your promises to them. Loving your neighbor is being just and merciful and faithful to them. And those illustrations point out that it's more than just outwardly keeping these rules that are in the law. It goes beyond having a heart of love that doesn't even want to do hard things to other people, doesn't want to hurt somebody else, doesn't want to overstep their boundaries. And that's what he's saying there. Now, we only have a few minutes, but I want to take part of chapter 6, not all of it, but part of it very quickly, and it's going to be a survey, not a detailed thing. In verses 1 through 15, Jesus shifts from what he's been talking about, those six examples of what true righteousness is, which is love. And he talks about what true service to God is, or what true worship is. This has to do now with piety toward God. And piety toward God was exhibited in a number of ways. One is by giving to the temple so that the poor could be relieved. This is giving alms. One was by prayer, obviously. One was by fasting. There are other ways. There are sacrifices and things like that, that by which God was worshipped. But Jesus gives three examples of ways that people tried to be pious or worshipful toward God. One was in the giving of alms, one was in prayer, and one was in fasting. Now, all three of these examples he gives have the same pattern. He says, when you do this, don't do it the way the hypocrites do, because they do it to be seen by men, and they have their reward. What he means is, the hypocrites, the Pharisees, when they give alms, when they pray in public, when they fast, they're doing it in a way that they hope people will notice and will give them credit for it. They want the praise of men, and they have it. Therefore, they have their reward. The reward they want is the reward they have. But he says, you should be seeking a reward from your Father, a different reward than that. And to get the reward from your Father, you have to do it differently than they do it. Because you have to do it not to be seen by men, but to please God. If necessary, be totally secretive about it. Although, of course, Jesus uses some hyperboles here. This is one thing we need to know reading the Sermon on the Mount. There's a lot of hyperbole. What is hyperbole? It's over-exaggeration to make a point stronger, yeah. When he says, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, obviously that's not literal. Your hands don't know anything. When he says, when you pray, go into your closet, shut the door behind you, don't let anyone see you praying, that's a hyperbole too. I mean, you might literally need to do that sometimes, but he's not forbidding public prayer. There's public prayer in the Bible. Jesus himself prayed in front of his disciples, and the apostles in Acts prayed publicly. He's not forbidding public prayer. He's saying, listen, you need to guard your heart about these things, because if you're doing these to be seen by men, then men will see you. They will appreciate you, and you will get what you wanted, but you're settling for far less than you should be settling for. You should be wanting a reward from God rather than the reward of man's approval. The Pharisees settle for a reward that you shouldn't settle for. They're glad if people see them and think they're holy and spiritual men. And people do. And therefore they have their reward. But God doesn't think they're spiritual. God knows they're doing this out of pride. They're doing this out of arrogance. They're hoping to be appreciated. They're hoping to be respected for their religiosity. If you've got any of that in you, get rid of it. Otherwise you'll have no reward from your Father in heaven. And so he gives the extreme case. Don't even let your left hand know what your right hand's doing. It's obviously not literal, but the idea is that you should be so secretive that even the other parts of your body don't see you doing it. Now, you don't have to be that secretive. I've known people who, when they give gifts, they don't sign the checks, or they'll just give cash and not a check because they don't want anyone to know that they gave to a charity or something like that. That's not a bad thing, but I think that's going further than Jesus intended. Jesus is not saying that it's always wrong for someone to know you gave a gift, but if you're doing it to be seen by men, and you can't do it without being conscious of, I hope people will see what I'm doing, then you better start doing it more secretly. Do it in a way that you know precludes your doing it for the wrong motives. Same thing with the private prayer in the closet. There's always a place for private prayer in the closet, but he's not saying that all prayer has to be that way. But if you cannot pray in public without being mindful, I wonder if people realize how spiritual I am or think I'm spiritual the way I'm praying, well, then you better just confine your prayers to the closet. And when you're fasting, don't look like you're fasting. Don't think, oh, I hope they see how much I'm suffering for Jesus by fasting. Try not to look like you're fasting. But in addition to these things, he talks about prayer. He has another section about prayer. When he talks about almsgiving, prayer, and fasting, he says in every case, don't do it like the Pharisees, or he says the hypocrites. He means the Pharisees. Don't be like the hypocrites when you do these things. Do it differently so God will reward you openly. But then when it comes to prayer, he has another section, another pericope added in there. And he says, when you pray, don't be like the heathen either. Don't be like the pagans. Now, when you pray, don't be like the Pharisees, but you also make sure you're not like the pagans. There's two ways not to pray, and then there's a way to pray. And he gives the example of how to pray. The pagans, they don't really believe their God is listening. They think they manipulate the gods by prevailing in chatter and a lot of verbiage and things like that. But they're not praying with faith that they're being heard by a real God who's going to answer like a father answers a child's prayers. They're just hoping by doing a lot of a lot of prayer, verbal activity, that maybe that'll get something done. Jesus says it doesn't take that. It can be a very short prayer, a very simple prayer. Let me give you an example. When you pray, pray like this. The prayer he gives, how long does it take to pray that out loud? Anyone ever time it? If it's more than 10 seconds, you're going really slow. He's not saying you should never pray longer than 10 seconds. But he is saying that the length of your prayers is not what's going to be important. It's, of course, the motivation and the faith and the state of your heart. He actually says that you need to make sure you've forgiven everybody so that you can be forgiven too. He says that after he gives the model prayer. But even the prayer itself says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debters. The point is, he says, there's only a few things you need to pray, and God's not impressed by a lot of words. You can say these things real briefly. First, pray that God's name will be hallowed. Secondly, pray for his kingdom to come and his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. Something that was in the process of happening when he was here and is still going, because the kingdom is still growing and coming to new regions through the preaching of the gospel. And that God's will be more done than it is now on earth. That more people will be willingly doing the will of God, just like everyone in heaven does. That's what we're supposed to be praying for. We can pray for our food too, and other needs, I'm sure. Give us this day our daily bread. It's not asking an awful lot, just the bread I need today. I'll ask for tomorrow's tomorrow. I'm not asking for a big stockpile here. I'm not asking to be made wealthy. I'm just asking for the things I need. I'm God's servant. I have every right to expect that he wants to feed and meet all the needs of his servant, so there's nothing wrong with asking. In fact, you should ask. Ask and you will receive, he said in chapter 7. Seek and you'll find. Asking for your own needs is not wrong at all in prayer. It's not selfish if it's not selfish. But it's not first. First is your kingdom come, your will be done. Prayer is for God's will, not mine. Even when I pray for my needs, I'm not praying for my dreams to come true. I'm praying for my food that I need today so I can keep serving God. The prayer of the disciples, the prayer of a servant to his master, or a child to his father. And the servant is about his master's business. The child is about his father's business. The prayer is addressed to the Father. Jesus said, when you pray, say, Our Father. Now, some people pray to the Holy Spirit, some pray to Jesus. I'm not saying that's wrong, but when Jesus said, when you pray, pray Our Father. So that's what I usually do. Pray to the Father. And then, of course, you pray that God will not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Also, you have to pray for forgiveness of sins. But forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us is a conditional thing. I've sinned, I need forgiveness, and I'm forgiving even now those who have sinned against me, so forgive me the way I'm forgiving them. And if I can't forgive them, if I don't forgive them, I can't ask for forgiveness either. And Jesus makes that plain in the verses that follow the sample prayer. He's in verse 14 and 15, if you won't forgive, God won't forgive you. Jesus says that a number of other times in his ministry too, as we'll see, especially in chapter 18 of Matthew. So, then of course you pray that God will not simply lead you into, but through, safely through temptation. You will be tempted, you will be tested, that's part of life. God's going to lead you into testing, but you're praying that he'll lead you through it and deliver you from it safely, without falling. That you'll be delivered from the evil one. So prayer is for warfare. That's a warfare request. I'm attacked by the devil. Give me victory over the devil. Deliver me from the devil. Prayer is basically imploring that God would bring his kingdom about here on earth as it is in heaven. That he'll provide our essential needs for daily life. That our relationship with him will be uninterrupted, so he'll forgive us routinely, and will, as we forgive others, as he insists that we do, and that he will be the one who gives us victory over the enemy who seeks to spoil us and destroy our Christian lives. So these are the main categories that prayer is for. That doesn't mean you can't pray for other things, or that you can't pray more things within the same categories. It's kind of a skeleton prayer, I think. When I pray, I like to use it as a skeleton prayer, sort of the outline. I want to get to each category. I think of other things in the category that are on my mind to pray for, but moving through, because it's the priorities in their proper order, apparently. And so this is how to pray when you pray. Now, therefore, Jesus has taught about how to give alms, how to pray, and how to fast in a way that's pleasing to God. Obviously, many more things could be said about fasting, but they're not in this teaching here. Or about prayer, or even about giving alms. The Bible has a lot to say about it. And this is one of those things where if we had forever, I'd go all over the Bible bringing out things about fasting and prayer and things and just make a comprehensive teaching on it. But that's what Jesus does here. That's not what we have time to do here either. We're going to stop there. And we'll have to come back to tomorrow to the second half of the Sermon on the Mount and blast through the rest. you have to realize I'm just skimming the most shallow surface of this sermon as we go through. I don't know how to go any faster with it, but we'll be able to do more. I will emphasize in the remainder of our lectures those things that are unique to Matthew, though, because you're going to also go through Mark and Luke in the next few weeks, and a lot of it's repetition. So I'm going to make sure that the things I do dwell on are the things that are what Matthew includes and the others don't, because the parts I leave out are the parts you're going to encounter in the other Gospels anyway. I wouldn't like to leave anything out. You know, if you go to my website, thenarrowpath.com, when you're done with the school, look at my Matthew lectures, there's 200 of them. They're only 22 minutes each, so it's only 70 hours. But the truth is that, but it's verse by verse in depth on Matthew, and it's if you want to go into deeper than I can go here, you can do it there at the website. All right.